The following program has been rated GE by the Kenya Film Classification Board. It is therefore suitable for general family viewing.
Thank you so much for joining Chungu GBS Television. This is Chungu Cha Jamii. I am your host, Ruth Muniu. We want to discuss about parenting and society. As parents, do you think what you are giving in is what you are receiving? We are bringing up our children to this society, and we are giving each and every good gift to these children. Are we receiving equal to what we are giving? That is why we want to discuss about parenting and the society. We have a parent, a teacher, and a counselor. He's going to tell us whether what the parents are giving to their children is what they are receiving at the other end. Also, we have a man of God who is going to tell us, teach us through the word of God, what should we give to our children and what should we expect out of them. Pastor Wimana has been guiding us, teaching us the word of God, and I'm very sure so many have found their roots and their destiny, where they are going and where they are planning to spend their eternity. He's here once again to tell us about this issue of parenting and what we should expect in the society. Pastor, say hi to our viewers as we continue.
So much for also allowing me to be with all of you once more again. And I'm very thankful because we can speak about parenting and the society, because as you know, at any one given time in our life, we have to be parents. And I really believe that once you grow up, actually, you become a parent, whether you have your own children or you don't have your own children. Mm. And especially as a pastor, I felt I have a lot of duty to be a parent of many people. Mm-hmm. So I'm very thankful to be able to speak about that.
All right, Pastor. Mm. You are a parent. You have your own children.
I have my own children.
Also, children. You have your spiritual children. Yeah,
many sons and daughters spiritually.
Do you think what you give, you are receiving the same?
Oh, okay. There's something very interesting, because when you actually, what we plant in the people, right? Mm-hmm. Planting the word of God. When I see the word of God actually, mm-hmm. you know, reaching that sort of people, changing their lives, and you know, making their life to be beautiful, mm-hmm. I'm very thankful. Because also, there are many whom I meet and they are struggling in their lives. They mm-hmm. they don't know where to go. But then when they receive this word of God, you know, mm-hmm. now they are able to exalt not only the word of God that they have received, but also they are able to exalt this preacher. Who preach the gospel to them and say, oh, you are my dad, you are my mentor, you are this and that to me. Mm-hmm. And really also when I feel and when I see, I've got very strong attachment with such people that I've been able to guide spiritually.
Wow, that's wonderful. Yeah. So it means if all parents mm-hmm. could be giving such like what you are giving to your spiritual babies and your biological babies, mm. our society could be different.
Yeah, I'm very convinced. You know, at a certain time in the Bible, you know, especially in the book of John, and the book of First Peter, right? Bible says, desire the sincere milk of the word of God so that you may grow thereby. Mm-hmm. So spiritual babies, they need the spiritual milk, and that is the word of God. And when this word of God comes to our lives, actually, mm-hmm. our life can only be different and completely different. I've never seen anyone who received the word of God mm-hmm. and it remains the same. I'm foolish before I received the word of God, but after I received the word of God, this word of God brings wisdom in my life. Mm-hmm. I'm, you know, distressed and I don't know how to solve my problems before the word, but surprisingly, when I receive the word of God, I can see how this word of God is overcoming all the problems that I'm encountering in my life.
Thank you so much. Yeah. We have our guests. He's going to tell us who he is. Karibu, tell us your name and what you do for a living.
Thank you very much mm-hmm. for inviting me for this particular program, which I truly believe that it is going in a very long way to help form some pillars and firm foundation, mm-hmm. especially for us as parents, as we go about our daily duties in promoting the lives of our children mm-hmm. and those who are directly or indirectly related to us. My name is John Njuguna Chege. Mm-hmm. I am a teacher, I am a parent, and I'm also involved in so many ways as a facilitator of youth activities. So when I look at the issue of parenting, first and foremost, I look at it from my very first initiative as a parent to children whom I have mm-hmm. biologically produced, mm-hmm. Whom I have a moral obligation and duty to ensure that they not only get what they deserve to get, but I also go an extra mile in laying a foundation for them to become responsible members of our wider society. Mm-hmm. In my other responsibility as a teacher, I still believe that I'm a parent. If you count the number of days I stay with the students, 5 days in a week, and sometimes 6 days in a week, you realize that I'm more of a parent even than the parents who have produced the very same.
Yeah, indeed.
So it gives me a very good chance mm-hmm. to get to know their character, to get to know their strengths, their weaknesses, mm-hmm. and as a responsible teacher, I should not only teach in class, but should go an extra mile and help them in ways I feel will make them better than possibly they could be. Then in my role as a youth facilitator, mm-hmm. I have so many, more than even my family, that I have to work with, helping them, mm-hmm. enabling them not to be influenced by the peer pressure. And some of them even working closely with them as their mentor mm-hmm. so that they do not only build their careers, but also eventually come up with strong families.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Our SMS line is 24411. Talk to us. Do you think what the parents are doing is enough to sustain our society? Let's find out in this program. Ask a question. Also, you can comment, give us a way forward, give us a suggestion what we can do. What is that parents are not doing? And that is why we are having a very difficult and a problematic society. Mr. Njuguna, as a teacher, and I believe the role of a teacher is not only to teach our children, to impart knowledge in our children. Also, you have other responsibilities besides that. Do you think what teachers are doing is enough to have a sound and happy society?
I think it depends with who is that person you are calling the teacher. Mm-hmm. It also matters a lot as to whether that particular teacher sees himself or herself as having another responsibility other than simply just going to class, mm-hmm. covering the syllabus, each lesson, marking the work done by the students, mm-hmm. and even giving a comment based on how they have performed. We must go beyond that. And sometimes I feel pained when I see that a student whom I'm teaching could be performing very well academically, but when it comes to issues pertaining to his character, I realize that the student could be deviating. Mm-hmm. And I feel I have a challenge of ensuring that I tow him back to line, because I can simply look at him or her and see that there is a future in this particular student or whom I can refer to as a child. Mm-hmm. And being a teacher and a parent, I believe I have to combine the two to produce a desirable character. Sometimes we fail as teachers if we look at our work as not a calling, mm-hmm. but simply as just a job. For a job, you simply just go in the morning, and then possibly by 5, your duty is over. But as a teacher who is a parent, mm-hmm. and who is supposed to be mentoring, you must think about that particular student 24 hours every day, mm-hmm. in a week, in a month, in a year.
Let's say you have a class of 40 students. Do you think among the 40, could there be failures in that class? And if at all there is, how can you turn their failure to be success?
We would not really call them failures as such. What we see in students is that as a result of the peer pressure, and sometimes if they feel that somehow their interest is not too much on them, they might tend to go out of the way. When I identify such a case, and I also believe my colleagues in the same profession would also similarly look at it from the same angle, I try to go and dig deeper to get to know what is this that could be ailing the student, because I look at that as some kind of a sickness. And then I may not address that particular issue during my normal class time. I can address that particular student later within my program. I can squeeze. And if the student is open to me, sometimes you realize that what could be ailing him is a problem that comes from the wider society, or even from the family where the student may come from. And any particular student that you are given the responsibility to mold him or her. They may have their different abilities. That's why I said from the very beginning, I do not look at them as failures or failing, and that is why I should come in. Maybe the student may not even be aware of the hidden abilities or gifts or talents that he or she could be having. That's my responsibility to identify and help him or her to nurture the same, and also make him or her feel that irrespective of the distance, irrespective of the problems back at home, he or she is a member of that particular society, and he or she has his rightful position, which we should help him to infiltrate and come up becoming a responsible person.
In the society, we have seen so many problems coming up, like youngsters who doesn't want to be guided by their parents, they don't listen to their teachers, they involve themselves in different activities. Where can you point your finger to? Is it the parents? Is it the teachers? Who is sleeping on his job?
I think when you look at it, there are a number of factors that could lead to the same. If you look at our current situation, the type of societies that we have, they are totally different from what was there some few years back, or when we were young children, where every member of the society felt he or she had a responsibility of attending to a problem, especially in character formation, of a child from the neighborhood or from the community. So that aspect of individualism, which could be affecting the parents and other members of the community, could be one of the causes to the same. Where I feel that as long as mine is not engaged in any evil or in any wrong act or a case of indiscipline, then I'm Mr. Perfect or Madam Perfect. But if you have to look at it, that child belongs to us. Actually, we normally say that a child is a reflection of the society and is a product of the society. So we should take the challenge and help that particular child. We should not leave it to the parents or the relatives. Actually, some of them may not even be anywhere near. Then the other aspect I feel could possibly be contributing, especially in urban centers, is that aspect of urbanization, where people are living their own lives in isolation without any concern or very less concern of what the neighborhood could be doing. It's not a surprise that you may open your gate to a child who requires some assistance and whom you regard as a stranger, yet he is from the next door. So our aspect of ignorance, because of being too busy and also because of the factors of urbanization, could be eaten into the particular type of children that we are given in our schools, the ones we take to pastor in the church, and the ones we have in the wider society. Then I also feel sometimes the types of families that we have. Currently, you hear of all manner of families. During our times, you remember, it was the issue of a mother and a father.
And many children. And many children.
Currently, and many children within the society.
Yes.
Currently, you hear of There is, of course, we accept them. Single families. Mm-hmm. We have the street families who may not even have anything to care about them. And all those aspects brought in together mm-hmm. could be leading to the type of the children that we could be having in our society. I believe there could also be other aspects, like the social trends, mm-hmm. The media, mm-hmm. the form of social media that we have, where sometimes the parents are giving too much time mm-hmm. To their kids engaging the same, or possibly that parent could also be somewhere busy in the same room, mm-hmm. maybe on the mobile phone or on a tablet, WhatsApping, Facebooking, and with no concern as to what the child could be doing. What the child may get there may infiltrate the mind, and this might lead mm-hmm. to a person having a negative mindset based on the influences that could be there. There are many.
Actually, he reminds me when I was young, right? I was beaten by everybody. Even this mother from the neighborhood, she will beat me if she finds me in a mistake. Mm-hmm. My older brothers will beat me. My sisters will beat me. No, I was the last born. So
why are you naughty by then?
Yes, I was. See, my father, of course, my mother, you know. So I would not actually mess up with my life, you know, mm-hmm. because I know very well, even though this is not my mother, but she has, the, you know, she's allowed. She can beat me seriously. Mm-hmm. Even though this father that is not my father, but then, she has the duty to beat me and to, you know, correct me. And I guess, you know, that actually has been lost. You know, we have to agree with that. Mm-hmm. Children are left to their own mothers and mm-hmm. their own fathers. Mm-hmm. And whenever you see somebody, you know, messing up or doing something wrong, you say, who cares? This is not my child, you know. And as our teacher says, mm-hmm. as long as your child has not been involved in something wrong, you become like Mr. or Madam Perfect, which actually I tend to disagree. We have to... to come up with a wholesome kind of education to mm-hmm. our children. Mm-hmm. In the church, I'm very thankful because, you know, I don't regard the child of so-and-so as his child. This is the child of the church, you know, mm-hmm. he belongs to me. And of course, when he grows and has problems, the problem will not just remain in his own nuclear family, mm-hmm. but the problem spread all over, even in the church, you know. So that's why it's very important to be able to understand that, you know, the child belongs to the society, does not belong just to one person, you know.
Oh, right.
And nowadays, as you know, the way he's saying, mm-hmm. the child is the child to the auntie, you know. Yeah.
So, Mwalimu, as a teacher, and maybe you have so many children before you, every morning they report, every morning you go to this class, and maybe come evening you know what they are going to do. And where you are living, your neighborhood, you can see how these students, the youngsters, they are behaving. How can we rectify this situation?
In fact, incidentally, the pastor has also reminded me. Mm-hmm. When I was young, mm-hmm. me, I am a firstborn in a family of six. But we lived in a wider society mm-hmm. where every child belonged to everyone in the compound. And to be very sincere, my home was near a road. We used to play various sorts of games that mm-hmm. boys could play then, mm-hmm. Including sliding during the wet weather. Mm-hmm. If we would spot a teacher coming, we would run without looking at any other direction until we would reach our homes, and possibly in the comfort of our parents' bedrooms, because the teacher would follow us to the homes. Mm-hmm. That is the type of a society that we lived in. And possibly it helped us to be who we are at the moment. Mm. Possibly there is something that we did that messed up the good that had been done as of yesterday mm-hmm. when we gave the child to you. And then within our neighborhoods, we note that because of all those influences, sometimes we feel it is becoming almost like a disease. It's our responsibility mm-hmm. in our every walk of life not to ignore something that happens to be affecting a child. Because you never know, that is the child who could possibly tomorrow be the doctor when you are sick in hospital. Sure. So if we waste that particular child, that particular time, and at an early age, mm-hmm. he might not end up having that doctor. Mm-hmm. So when we note something wrong within our society, irrespective of the criticism that we may face, mm-hmm. we should speak out. We should try to offer an advisory role to the child. Mm-hmm. We can talk to the child. We can talk to other people who could be closely related with a particular child, mm-hmm. not with the aim of having the kid been admonished, but with the aim of trying to perfect. Because like we were those days, mm-hmm. all those aspects of influences, if we do not control some of them, they might end up messing a whole society.
Mwalimu, do you think parents are ready for their children to be corrected? Like you find my daughter doing something and you take the responsibility of correcting her. Do you think as a parent, I'll receive you like you did it very well, thank you so much, keep it up? Do we have such kind of parents in the society?
I don't know whether I can remember the person who sang that song. The person says in Swahili, tenda wema, nenda zako. So if we are trying to do something good, we should not look back or expect to be appreciated. Because the very type of parents we are having, the modern day parents, they might be a mixture of what we have already stated earlier. Which means there are some who may appreciate what you are doing in helping them as they take care of their children. Because you're also playing a role there. But there are some who might feel you are becoming too much or too hard on their kids, yet you are not the parent. Some would not even want a relative to help them correct a wrong done by the child.
And even but they can take you to a police station.
Yes. But even then, should we simply just let it, let it go just like that? I believe if we were to work in close conjunction with other bodies, like the pastors, like other teachers, other members of the society, I believe there is something we can do to impact. The parents may not realize what we are doing, but one day they will reap the fruits of our labor.
Thank you so much. We are going to take a short break, and please stay tuned. When we come back, we shall continue. Welcome back. As we were discussing about parenting and society, talk to us through our SMS line 21144. We've been listening to a teacher and a facilitator. He's also a parent, and he's giving us this example that before, our children were being raised by the society. How about today? Our children have become our personal children. They cannot be controlled or taken a step by a neighbor, somebody who is older than them. And this is leading us to destruction. Let us listen from the good book, how our pastor can guide us, how to bring up our children in the right way so that we can have a sound society.
Thank you. I don't know whether you know a city called Detroit in America. Actually, Detroit was a very nice city. And also Ford, the car company, was actually located in Detroit. But sometimes around the 70s, 80s, this city collapsed and people migrated from the city. Now actually it's in total ruins. But the reason is what? Around 1946, after the Second World War, there was somebody who was a doctor of children. It's called Benjamin Spock. Dr. Benjamin Spock wrote a book. The book was known as Baby and Child Care. It's a book that was written and and published in millions of copies. They bought it so much, sometimes printed with a different cover, but then the content was the same. The summary of the book is like this. You give the milk to the crying child, right? So the child that is crying, I mean, whatever the child wants, you give and provide. And I'm also tempted to believe that from the time the American society was created, such a mind was very new, because there before, the Christians that had migrated from England, they took care of their children. They did not just allow them to receive whatever they wanted. They knew how to control their their desires. They knew how to cut down their desires, and they were actually also planting the wisdom in the hearts of the children. But after the book was written, now the parents started to give the children whatever they required, whether it's good, whether it's bad, you know. They did not interfere with children in any way, right? Mm-hmm. That's why when these children grew up and when they started to work, they couldn't be productive in the society. Instead, they began to unite, to come up with unions. They fight against the CEOs, and finally, you know, the company of Ford collapsed. Not only the company itself, but also the city itself. Mm-hmm. You know, one big automobile company, when it's there, right? There are many small other companies which are connected to it, because not just one company can make and prepare all spare parts. Yeah. So that's why the whole city of Detroit actually collapsed when Ford, as a motor vehicle manufacturer company, collapsed down. Mm-hmm. Why? Because of the workers, the employees they had, their kind of mindset was very wrong. Why? Because it's no longer the mindset of a Christian, that's the mindset of of Benjamin Spock, you know, who said, give milk to the crying baby. Now, why am I saying this? Actually, the Bible speaks that the heart of a child is having a lot of foolishness, right? When children are young, they are foolish, they have a lot of desires, ambitions, what's and what. So, but then you should never leave them alone. They have to be interfered. They have to be corrected. They have to be chastised. They have to be rebuked. They have to learn how to break their hearts. Here the Bible says, train up a child in the way he should go. And when he's old, he will not depart from it. From the time they're young, they have to be trained. Mm-hmm. From the time they're young, they should be taught. You understand when you talk about a trainer? A trainer is somebody who's like an anyosha, right? You correct, the life of somebody, When the life is crooked, there should be somebody who has to say, the life you are following, the way you are going is very wrong, So that's why the society needs to play that role. Of course, father and the mother, they're the very first person to do it. But also, as I said, we have many problems in the society owing to the types of families that we have, right? There are many mothers who got married with their children. When they go into a new family, now the children will be the stepchildren. And when the father of that family wants to correct the behaviors of that child, the mother doesn't want to accept it, say, no, don't touch my child. Or else, oh, you are beating my child because a stepchild to you. don't touch my daughter, don't touch my son. And because of that, children will just, be crooked and go the wrong way. Leave alone that. Even children who actually were in the same family, they may end up, belonging to one parent, When the other parent is harsh, trying to correct and rebuke and chastise, children, they go to their side. Mm-hmm. I was having fellowship with a certain father. He says, my children are spoiled because of their mother. Mm-hmm. Who's their mother? Their mother actually is his wife, right? They have the children together. But then he says, whenever I would start to talk to the children, want to correct and guide them, the mother would come and say, don't touch my children. Don't say anything here. I know I'm taking care of them. Then the father would always, because of the peace of the home, would always keep quiet. But now children, they are beyond control. Mm-hmm. He tells me, it's children now, or they are like, they are girls actually. They are 20, 21, 22. Mm-hmm. But then where they sleep even for a week, for a month, he does not know. That's the father's heart now. He says, my children, I think he who spoiled them was my wife. Mm-hmm. So it's very important to be able to understand actually, both parents have to combine efforts together so that they can be able to take care of the children. Mm-hmm. So that the child can wrong me and then run to the mother and the mother embraces. No. Mm-hmm. Actually, when we start to fight, we have to fight together, right? I and my wife have to be one side, and then you have to make sure that the children actually give up and mm-hmm. they can break their hearts. They can realize, oh, here, if I don't break my heart, if I don't change my heart, then I won't mm-hmm. succeed. Mm-hmm. So anyway, even here the Bible says actually, foolishness is bound in the heart of a child, but the rod of correction shall drive it far from him, right? Mm-hmm. So there is foolishness, yes, He does not know how to live his life. He does not know which step to put first, right? Mm-hmm. He does not know which decision to make here and there. You know, children are like that. And we don't expect actually them to be mature and to make the right decisions from the very beginning. Mm-hmm. But then when they have a mentor, they have a teacher, they have a father, they have a mother, they have somebody who's next to them, mm-hmm. these children are able to grow up straightforward. But now the problem is, even the father is absent, even the mother is absent, you know, the pastor is not there, you know. You know, I'm very sure there are many pastors who are Sunday pastors. Other days they are busy doing their own works, but then on Sunday that's when they appear at the pulpit, right? And they are called pastor, you know.
Yeah.
So because of that, actually, we have lacked the teacher in the society.
Mm-hmm.
And children, when they are growing up, actually, they are left into the hands of, you know, house help.
Yeah.
The house help doesn't have the heart of the mother, mm-hmm. as you know very well.
Yeah.
She does the duty maybe to watch the child, provide food, right? That's the only thing she can do.
Mm-hmm.
You know, thinking about what will be the future of the child, knowing that the child now is being stubborn, has to be, you know, rebuked and corrected. In fact, even I think some of the house help, when they try to beat the child, right? You know, they are in a hot soup. That's they cannot actually even try. So that's why the child will grow up doing whatever he wants to do, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And by the time you feel like the child should break his heart, it's too late. Too late to correct. So,
mm-hmm.
but then the Bible speaks about the road of correction. Of course, I understand. It's not that when you beat, that's the time the child should change.
Mm-hmm.
But then, you know, as you mentor, as you guide, as you counsel, as you advise, as you actually, you be there with them, right? When they are crying, you should be able to know why they are crying.
Mm-hmm.
When they're happy, you should be able to know why they're happy. No, you should be able to even open their eyes for their future.
Mm-hmm.
Right now, there are many children who are taking things for granted. They don't know how to be thankful before their fathers. They don't know how to be thankful before their mother. You know, every time they take things for granted, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So that means there is a gap somewhere that somebody should fill. You know, parents are just busy making money, but what's the meaning of money if you lose your own children? You know, I mean, you lose their hearts, you know.
Mm-hmm.
As I told you, I really respected this one man who said that there are many boys who are not graduating to become men because
mm-hmm.
this is something I'm seeing on a daily basis.
Mm-hmm.
I'm seeing that on a daily basis. No, even though he's 25, even though he's 30, even though he's 40, still, you see, he does not know how to break his heart, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I was taught how to break my heart when I was young, and even though my mother was not really somebody who was very much vested in the word of God, but she knew at least
mm-hmm.
as a mother that she has to break my heart, right?
Yeah.
I wouldn't say that I won't eat, and then she start. No, running after me, please eat, please eat. She never did like that, right? I remember one day in the, you know, I think I was naughty and also my tongue was like sharp, you know. You know, so one time I was talking to my older brother. My older brother is like 10 years older than me.
Mm-hmm.
And that time I was already in college and I was a boy, just still young. So I think in the morning, that was a Sunday morning, I abused him and I don't know what kind of bad words I spoke out of my mouth. My brother was very angry and was like, thoroughly chastising me, you know. So I cried and until I just, you know, dried my tears. But when my mother came again, I began to cry. So now she asked me, why are you crying? I was beaten. Why were you beaten? Right? And my brother was there, you know, that boy. I was beaten again. So there I cannot but break my heart before my brother, before my mother, before my father, before everybody that is around me.
Mm-hmm.
But now, this self-denial, breaking your heart, deny yourself, who's teaching that in the society? So that's why it's very important for us to be able to realize that, you know, we are the ones who are spoiling our own children. Desire of children has to be controlled. It's not that they can be happy simply because they are living according to their flesh desires. The Bible says, indeed, there's a lot of foolishness in the hearts of children, but there's a road of correction.
Mm-hmm.
That road is not just, you know, this normal road, but that word that you give at the right moment, that advice that you give at the right moment, you being there to be together with your child. You know, I'm very sure there are many fathers outside here who are not even aware of whether their children, you know, what they're doing, how, you know, whom are they living together with, what kind of a life they are spending in the day. They don't know anything whatsoever. So these are strangers who are living together in the same house. And eventually, when you see your child is spoiled, you start now to shout, oh, my child is spoiled. Mm-hmm. You know, he spoiled him a long time ago because there was no one to correct him, because the Bible speaks about the rod of correction. There's no one who provides this rod of correction, you know. Mm-hmm. So the parents should be always having this rod of corrections in their hands, right? Leave alone their hands, even in their hearts, actually. I should be able to know this is something that I have to correct in my child. Mm-hmm. Whether you correct it through advising, you correct it through, you know, counseling, you correct it through, you know, beating sometimes, mm-hmm. you correct, you know. But it's very important, you know. Even Jesus Christ himself, somebody, I mean, my senior pastor was saying the other time that, you know, in the toolbox of Jesus, right? Mm-hmm. He called it a toolbox. Mm-hmm. Sometimes there's wrath. But sometimes also there's grace. Mm-hmm. Sometimes he reveals too much love. Some other times he feeds people. But sometimes he's seized with anger and wrath. Sometimes he takes a whip because of those things the child needs, mm-hmm. so that he can be, you know, indeed a proper citizen and a proper member of our society. Mm-hmm. But then when that is lacking, you know, we cannot expect teachers to do that, because also teachers, they are taken to justice when they beat children. You know, the mother will come shouting, you know, and you know, I'm very sure if, for example, you know, one mother comes and shouts, another one comes and shouts, and then another father comes and shouts, maybe they say, okay, fine, you know, I will not. And then that's why they are left only with the duty of giving knowledge only. But I don't know, what is knowledge? Knowledge is not wisdom. Mm-hmm. Our children needs above all wisdom, not just knowledge.
No, Pastor, that you have guided us, that we should not keep aside this road of correction.
Yes.
And already our society is in chaos. What is the way forward? What do we do? How do we talk to these parents so that they can listen to us and maybe receive what we are telling them?
Okay. In fact, what you are saying is very true, because we can feel the gap already. We can feel that there's no one who's moving with the road of correction outside here, right? The mother gave up, the father gave up, right? The teacher also gave up, because he doesn't want people to come and shout, you know, all the time, mm-hmm. right? So because of that, children are just, you know, going the wrong direction. You know, this is exactly also a sign that people have left the word of God. Of course, you know, people, they feel, they think, if my heart does whatever it wants, you know, that is healthy. Or if I don't want to do something, I don't do it, you know. They think it's okay, but that's not okay, right? It's not okay. I should be able to train my heart to do the things that my heart doesn't like, and even to stop to do the things that my heart wanted to do, you know. That's a training, and that very training actually will make my heart to be strong. Even when it is strong before difficulties, before challenges, before burdens, mm-hmm. I'm more than able to overcome, you know. We can see people are weak-hearted nowadays, and there are many, not just one or two. It takes only one word to break the heart of somebody, you know, right? Yeah. There are people when, for example, in the relationship, you know, they face a difficult situation, mm-hmm. they just think that's the end of everything. That's why they think, let me just take my life, and they commit suicide, you know. Mm-hmm. Why is that so? That's a sign of a weak heart. They cannot challenge anything. They cannot overcome any burden. You know, even though they have difficulties, they feel that's the end of everything. They don't want to go through challenges. Why? Because the society does not. Actually, we need above all this kind of mind education. Mm-hmm. We have to educate not only children even. Mm-hmm. I feel like whether they are parents, whether they are pastors, whether they are teachers, everybody. Mm-hmm. I'm very thankful, because in the IYF we want to continuously teach the mind education, even to teachers, even to policemen, mm-hmm. you know, even the need, right? Somebody said, you should now be able to reach up to the leaders as well, you know. Mm-hmm. But then the leaders, you know, they are too much committed to learn about this mind education. But mm-hmm. I think, you know, this is something, it's a war actually that we have to fight. Yeah. Until we find somebody who's moving with the rod of correction into his hands. Mm-hmm. It could be a mentor, it could be a teacher, it could be a parent. If all of us together we are moving with that kind of rod of corrections, mm-hmm. then our children will come back into the right track.
Wow. I'm longing to see this time come around. Okay, Mwalim, I want you to give our fellow parents a word of advice. Why are we killing our society? Because it is we who are parents of today who are killing the society. Why? We have kept aside the road of correction. we don't want our children to be touched by any other person apart from the mother and the father. What is your word of advice to them using that camera?
To the parents at home and in our society, I urge you, be it the father or the mother, because that is what we are not in, please do not be an absent parent. Get involved with what your child is learning from an early age. Work with him. Control the use of electronic gadgets and other forms of mass media. And if they have to be there, let us do them with a measure so that we do not waste and lose our children to the very same, only to cry later. At the same time, I strongly feel that caregivers, teachers, and the pastors, they should be given the respect they deserve and be given that opportunity to help come in and fill the gap of assisting in parenting. Because what we produce is, by the end of the day, going to infiltrate every sector of our society. And we shall be the very same people crying that the society has changed. One thing that should never be forgotten in our minds is, generations may come and go, but the act of parenting, or the act of parenting and having children, will forever be there. And without those children, then it means that our society will have come to an end. Hence the need to take up our responsibilities. We may not use the cane as teachers, but I still believe there is something we can do. We can use the counseling services and the skills to come in and try to control and manage the discipline of the students and the children in our midst. And by the end of the day, we may change the society. I also believe that mild education is actually, like Pastor has put it, one of the most important remedies to the ills that have begotten our society. It might be late for some of us, but for that child, it could actually be the best recipe that we could give to cure the situation.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate your concern and your advice. Pastor, let's listen to your parting shot as we wind up.
Okay, I'm very thankful because God is very clear on how we take care of our children. Of course, the Bible says that parents should not provoke their children, but then the Bible also ask the children to respect their parents, and I'm very sure once that is accomplished, once children and their parents, they are together in their hearts, I'm very sure, you know, this kind of relationship will affect positively the life of children, even their future. And of course, I won't understand, you know, a parent who does not know how to break the heart of the child, especially how he can teach himself denial, right? How he can plant wisdom in the child. And once actually the child gets wisdom, I'm very sure something which is more, much more important than even knowledge. So I'm really requesting that parents, together with all teachers, into society and even leaders, because also they are the ones who are taking care of many people. I hope all of them, they understand that, you know, we have the duty, the mandate to plant wisdom in that of our children. Once they are wise, they are more than able to live a very proper and a very profitable life in this generation.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Mr. Njuguna. You have given us what they really needed, because we can see the gap is there and it is widening day by day. But by the grace of God, if we can have people who are teaching our children, the facilitators, the parents coming together and uniting, I'm very sure we are going to save our society. So thank you so much for your time. Thank you, Pastor, for the guidance and advice. And surely, as Pastor was talking about, don't put the rod of correction away from your hand. It is very true that parents, we have relaxed. And if only we can keep the word of God in our hearts, also our society can heal. Chungu cha Jamii is aired every day, Monday to Friday at 11 a.m. Be sure to join us next time. Take care and God bless you all. Bye-bye.